flesh. Do you know who I am? God in the flesh. The word of God in the book has been shown to you. The most powerful of all prophets. The prophet that's found in the book. Lo, in the Bible, the book that is written to me in Psalms 40, I come to do thy will, O God. Thy law, prophecy, is within my heart. Now what better sinner can know a sinner than a godly sinner?
Okay, welcome to the part three of the exposition on the foundation. David Koresh, Magnum Opus. I call Magnum Opus, that's my opinion, it's not what he said, but this is, to me, of all the preserved materials that we have, this is the most complete and succinct explanation of his doctrine that he ended up with at the end of his ministry before he died. So we will get started here. I've been working on my audio and also trying to get the screens to work correctly in terms the transitions and everything. Been getting better at that. I'm learning how to use this software. It's called OBS Studio, shareware. So I'm also trying to learn how to look at the camera instead of look somewhere randomly like an idiot. But anyway, let's get started here. We left off about 25 minutes in, and he was talking about the Laodicean. So now we're going to switch, and we started here at this section where John opens the door in heaven. This is Revelation 4. And we're going to start getting really heavy duty here. Now, one of the things, if he says something that you don't understand and I don't comment on it either, I mean, you can leave a comment, you know, if it's bothering you. If I don't comment on something, it's because either A, I basically kind of agree with him. When I say I agree with him in the context of, God, how do I say this? It doesn't mean I agree with him all the way to the end in terms of his application, okay? But I would agree with him that maybe there's a point there to be made that would be generally applicable to in certain situations or something like that. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. So, a lot of the stuff he's, like I said before, he's not wrong about everything. So a lot of the stuff that he's saying is straight from the Bible. You know, he's understanding the text properly. So he's right as far as it goes. But on the other hand, you know, he might go too far with it sometimes. So, okay, one thing I wanted that I thought of from the last study that I want to mention is there are seven churches in Revelation 2 and 3, right? So he concentrates on the Laodicean church. And the question I would ask, and maybe he had a good answer for this, I don't know, he doesn't explain it obviously there, but I would say, well, why are we just concentrating on the Laodiceans? What's the theory behind that? You might say because it's the seventh and we're at the end of time, right? Like, okay, maybe, you know, I've just been thinking about that. Like in other words, you have to have what's called a hermeneutic. That's a rule of interpretation. A presupposition is another way to put it, right? What's your presupposition? In other words, presuppositions are your starting assumptions that you may not even state. Like he has a lot of presuppositions here. When he's talking, he has a lot of things that are just in the back of his mind as obvious facts, which may not be so obvious depending on what he's talking about. So that was just a thought. I don't want to go too much into that. I don't, you know, I'm just was thinking about that. So that's would be an interesting question. I hope that text is large enough. I've been trying to figure out how to make it larger without. Yeah, let's try that. Let's make it a little bit larger. Okay, let's begin.
John beholds a door open in heaven, and the voice of the Holy Ghost, the unidentifiable Christ, the Spirit of truth, which the world cannot receive.
Right there. The unidentifiable Christ. I must admit, I don't fully understand what he's talking about, but he's linking the Holy Ghost and Christ in some way that's important to his theology, and he's done this before. How did the Spirit overcome for it? Christ overcame. He says, how did the Spirit overcome? So he's got a tight connection between Christ and the Spirit. We'll talk about that soon again. Just want to note that.
Because it seeth him not. This Spirit commands John to come up hither to see the beginning of the creation of God in the end. To see things which must be hereafter. To see the power of God that proclaimed heaven and earth into existence. This is the Spirit I'm talking about. It's not the Spirit of the visions. It's the Spirit of God. The Spirit of the visions is recorded in the book of Peter. But not unto themselves, but unto us they prophesied. And they diligently searched into those things. Prophets were never given the ability to know what they prophesied about. None of them did. Daniel, Jeremiah, Isaiah, none of them did.
Okay. Did you see that? Prophets were never given the ability to know what they prophesied about. None of them. He doesn't qualify it. Right? Well, I don't agree. He is using a source text. He's using 2 Peter, right? Second Peter, I don't know how closely he's quoting this, but not unto themselves, but unto us they prophesied, and they diligently searched into those things. So one thing I'll note, one of the things that David Koresh would do when he was looking at the New Testament is he would emphasize sometimes if a writer in the New Testament, like Paul or Peter, for here in this example, was saying us, right? Which is what Peter says. Unto us. For example, I don't know how much of you know this, but David Koresh started teaching, well, Vernon Howell, that's what he was when he started teaching around 1986. Contrary to common belief, the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ did not actually die for our sins, like this generation or previous generations, that he died for the sins of the people that lived from the time of Adam until 31 AD. And so he would have to die as a second Messiah to atone for the people, sins from 31 AD to the present day. Okay, so I haven't talked about that too much. When he would say, well, when Paul was talking, for example, about Jesus dying, he died for us, he would say. Well, and then he would point out, well, Paul says us. Who's us? Us is the people that lived in those days, right? He's not talking about us here today. So the point I'm trying to make is, well, hey, back at you, buddy. If Peter's talking about not unto themselves, but unto us they prophesied, well, here Koresh seems to want to say that the us is him and, you know, his people that are in the room there, right? Yeah. So, inconsistency in your interpretational rules is one of the things that he would do. In other words, us is either them or us, depending on what is convenient. That is the thing that I would note here. As far as prophets not knowing what they ever prophesied about, I'll just give an example. Okay, so we'll go to Isaiah 37. I'm just going to briefly quickly go through this. So in Isaiah 37, the situation is that the Assyrian is knocking at the door. And we're going to be talking about the Assyrian, if some of you have seen one of my videos. So Hezekiah is upset, and he sends his servants to Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos. And this is very straightforward. They tell him, "Hey, the king says this, we're in trouble here. Day of trouble, rebuke, blasphemy. Children have come to the birth, not strength to bring forth," right? It's a powerful image. We're right up to the edge here, but we can't seem to. It's a mess. And so the servants of King Hezekiah came to Isaiah. So Isaiah has a message for them about the situation. Thus shall he say to your master, which is the king Hezekiah, thus saith the Lord, be not afraid of the words that thou hast heard, wherewith the servants of King Assyria has blasphemed me. If you go to the previous chapter, chapter 36, this will show what the Assyrians said. A lot of big boastful words and everything, threatening the city of Jerusalem. Behold, I will send a blast upon him. More message. Thus shall you speak, Hezekiah, King Judah, saying, let not the God of the trust deceive thee. Excuse me, this is what the Assyrians are saying, right? Hezekiah prays in the temple. Okay, so Hezekiah prays here to God, and then God answers through Isaiah again. I'm sorry if I'm going through this so fast. The point I'm trying to make is that if we look at this text, which is Isaiah, he's prophesying. Are you trying to tell me that he doesn't understand what he's prophesying about? This is specifically a situation that existed in Isaiah's day. Okay? So this idea that the prophets never, remember, he said never. He said prophets were never given the ability to know what they prophesied about, and then he says none of them, and he doesn't qualify. So I've just given one text where you could examine it yourself and say, well, is this really true? I disagree with him. He's wrong. Wrong means in error, which means false. I disagreed with him at the time. I've disagreed with this ever since I heard it come out of his mouth. I find it to be completely stupid. And I don't think he's interpreting what Peter says properly. But anyway, let's continue. I've taken up enough time on that. So let's see here. Let's go on.
But now, the greatest of all prophets, the Spirit declares to be the Son of God. That's the subject we're talking about now. The prophets say one shepherd. Doesn't say two shepherds, does it?
This is complaining about Mark. Let me just say a brief note about Mark, bro. I wouldn't have believed it if I hadn't heard it with my own ears come out of, well, he I was talking to him on the telephone. Okay. Now, don't want to be seen as being biased, right? Okay, so I just want to try to be factual. So Mark Brough came into the group in 1986, and Mark Brough has his own experience, his own way of looking at things, right? He's an individual with those own, just to state the obvious here, his own individual, his own motivations, his own ideas, his own thoughts, his own experience. And so to me, that's important, to acknowledge people's experiences, which Koresh would sometimes not do. And we all have them, and they're important to us. And I'm not saying that your experience is the end all be all of everything, but it's, but people, you should at least consider it, which sometimes Koresh wouldn't do. In fact, there's a story where we went to visit my sister-in-law with Koresh one time. I haven't told that story yet, and that would illustrate this point, but we'll have that as another study. Okay, so when Mark Bro came into the group, he would talk about his visions, and Koresh has already mentioned, you know, complaining about Mark sharing his visions or writing them down or something. That's interesting too, that he would complain about writing them down, because Koresh was very oral. He didn't write much because he wasn't good at it. And again, that's okay as far as it goes. I mean, we're not all good writers, but there's nothing wrong with writing things down, in my opinion. I don't know why he would complain about that. But anyway, when Mark came into the group, his visions confirmed Koresh's inspiration. Okay? Then you might say, well, why did Mark turn against him later? Well, because the idea was that sure, Koresh was inspired at one point, but then at some point he became overcome by temptation, sexual temptation, and disobeyed God, which I don't agree with that personally. I used to believe that. At this point, the whole, I don't even believe in Seventh-day Adventism anymore. Okay, it was wrong from jump to state my position. I have enormous problems with the whole 1844 thing and all of that. I guess we could go into that some point if people want me to. But anyway, but there's another framework where you could say, okay, and I wouldn't argue with, if you want to believe this, that's fine. You would be, okay, well, Koresh was inspired. Vernon Hall came on the scene in 1983. And he did sort of had some inspirations from God, but then later on, as he started practicing polygamy, or when he started taking men's wives, which he would disagree with that phrase, but that's what he was doing. So I'll explain why he would disagree later. So Koresh was perfectly happy to have Mark come in and share his visions, because Mark's visions confirmed his message. Okay, as I stated. So, but years later, so this would have been 86. So in 1990, when I was talking to him on the phone one time, he's trying to boost me up. Okay, and he's putting Mark Bro down, because I had been there way before Mark Bro ever came, which was true. At one point in history, he didn't give a crap about this. And when he did this at the time, I kind of was like, how convenient. Now I'm, you know, now you're talking me up. Like, right. And then I mentioned Mark's visions, and it's like he had never heard of that before, in terms of that he had supported the visions, and he denied it. He's like, I don't know what you're talking about, or, and it was so bizarre. I think he was telling the truth, in the sense that he didn't remember. It's like a selective memory thing, where maybe some kind of psychological mechanism where when facts become inconvenient, you can literally forget them. So in 1990, all of a sudden, Mark's visions don't matter anymore, and he doesn't care about them, and they never mattered. Yeah, weird. So anyway, yeah, that's what he's complaining about. He's complaining about Mark Bro. He acknowledged that Mark Bro was a prophet, even if, you know, I think he called him half a prophet, a mini prophet, you know, because it kind of, I think there was always some tension, right? Like, okay, we got this guy coming in the group and has visions, and I like that because it supports me. But on the other hand, God talks to him and tells him things that he doesn't tell me. And so I think he was always kind of, unsecure about that in a way. And so to compensate, he would kind of make fun of Mark sometimes. And yeah. So again, in this conflict, I'm not 100% Mark Bro was perfect, did everything right, and cannot be criticized. That's not what I'm saying. I'm trying to be fair, but I I do believe that David Koresh went through some kind of psychological process, which I don't completely understand, where he kind of, in order to solve this conflict in his brain, a kind of a psychological trigger went off and he forgot about some of this stuff because it was inconvenient. I hope that makes sense. But anyway, let's continue. That's enough of that.
The prophets say one shepherd. Zechariah does not say in vain that if any shall yet prophesy, their mother and their father shall thrust them through with a sword.
Yeah, so that's a scripture in Zechariah. I don't agree with his application of this. But yeah, it does say something like that. So I'm not going to go into it. Maybe we could talk about that some other time. I'm not going to look it up. But yeah, sure, there's a prophecy in Zechariah talks about this stuff. He's applying it to the situation, obviously, that, you know, hey, Mark's in big trouble. You know, he's prophesying. That's could be serious business, right? He's still prophesying.
We have a schism amongst us. We have a schism. There's competition now. I'm happy. I'm happy to see that the Spirit now has opportunity to manifest herself in a way that we've never before seen.
I never saw any manifestation of the Spirit myself. That's my own opinion. You know, I never got clear answers to my questions. And we'll talk about that in the future. Just remember that. Put a pin in that. And he says he's happy. He says he's happy. But I guarantee you, from what I know about David Koresh, in the dark, at night, when he was alone, he had doubts about what he had done. No question about it. Because he paid a steep price for this path that he took. He paid a steep price. He would go through periods of darkness, as he would say in his study tapes a lot, because I think the periods of darkness were depression, and I think reality was creeping in on him. I mean, think about it. You're in this position where you're leading this group of people and you've got this enormous responsibility, which is true, and things have to be happening and you have to be teaching. It's a lot of pressure and it's a lot it's a burden, as he says here. You know, he says that. So every now and then, like, maybe reality starts creeping in. From my perspective, this is all ridiculous nonsense that he's ultimately doing. It's just, it's a facade, in my opinion. All these manipulation of scriptures and everything, it's impressive on one level. But if you start peeling away the layers and digging in, no, the spell is broken on me. So other people, wow, you know. So anyway, let's continue.
That we might discern the children of light and the children of darkness. There are those who have walked with us in the flesh. They have not been children of light. They say they have seen. They have seen. But now you see. They have seen nothing. We now realize more clearly the testimony of Uriah and the testimony of Zechariah, the son of Berechiah. Two stories of truth, two different meanings. One thing witnessed, two different forms of light. One light is darkness, one light is light. That's what I'm talking about.
Okay. I don't know how much of this we're going to get through today, because he's starting to get pretty deep into some stuff. And a lot of you are not going to have the slightest idea what he's talking about here. I know exactly what he's talking about here. Of course, this again is Mark Bro saying they have seen, and I guess the other Australians that broke away. Okay, so what this is a doctrine that David Koresh came, well, he would have been Vernon Howe, so he came up with this interpretation of Isaiah 8 in early, early days, all right? So that's what he's talking about. He's talking about Isaiah 8. Let's go to Isaiah 8. We're going to have to do this now so you can understand. Isaiah 8. Moreover, the Lord said unto me, Take thee a great roll, and write in it with a man's pen concerning Mahershalal-Hashbaz. And I took unto me faithful witnesses to record, Uriah the priest, and Zechariah the son of Jeberechiah. Jeberechiah, okay? And I went unto the prophetess, and she conceived and bare a son. Then the Lord said unto me, Call his name Mahershalal-Hashbaz. For before the child shall have knowledge to cry, My mother, my father, the riches of Damascus, and the spoil of Samaria shall be taken away before the king of Assyria. So this is about the Confederacy. Chapter 7 is about the Confederacy. Chapter 7 contains the famous verse, A virgin shall conceive and bear a son and call his name Emmanuel. So this is about the Confederacy. This is a Confederacy between Syria, ancient Syria, not Assyria, ancient Syria and ancient Israel. That's the northern 10 tribes uniting together in power against Judah, small two-tribe Judah to the south. So there are things going on here. The prophet Isaiah is involved. God is commanding him here to record this event, this birth. Isaiah goes unto the prophetess. There's no reason to not think the prophetess is his wife. It's perfectly reasonable to think that. Either a prophetess because she's the wife of a prophet, or a prophetess in her own right, and her ministry is just not recorded in the Bible for whatever reason. So Isaiah and his wife have a baby, and the baby is named Mahershalal-Hashbaz, and then all of this is recorded, okay? And then the faithful witnesses to record, obviously, are like a notary public. These are officials in the court who have been called to make note of this event. So like it's recorded down. These are witnesses. That is, if you ever have a question about what happened, you can call witnesses in, question them. Hey, did this really happen? Yes. Under cross-examination, things like that. That's what's going on. This is to formally record all this. Okay, so that's what's going on anciently. Now, it's really, to me, pretty ballsy for Koresh to talk about this. Because, again, I've talked about this in Adopted Son in Isaiah 8. And for me, in fact, I know from personal experience, because I saw it with my own eyes, this whole thing was actually a source of enormous embarrassment for David Koresh. He had sexual intercourse with Lois Roden. I know this because it came out of her mouth and he was in the room and she confessed it because she was tired of all the secrecy and all of the, you know, Vernon wanted to play games with this whole situation. For whatever reason, early in 1983, he decided that it was important in his mind to fulfill this text here, right? I being he's representing, he's antitypical Isaiah, right? And the prophetess is Lois Roden. And they had sexual intercourse. She said they did. He was there. He buried his head in his hands and just shook his hands. Lo, what are you doing? You know, because he's giving a study trying to convert people and she's messing everything up. And I was 18. I'm there listening to this. I didn't know it for sure. I didn't know for sure that this had happened. I was shocked. And anyway, so when he goes and he starts, I want to know something. Notice that it says Zechariah, the son of Jeberechiah. Okay? You see that? What does he say? He says Zechariah, the son of Berechiah. Now, that's a small difference. There's two letters missing there, but it's still different. Okay? This is the kind of thing that I would get jumped on about. You know, David, what are you doing? You're straining at gnats. Whatever. That's what you say. I'm paying attention to the text. I'm being strict to the text. So the reason that he says Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, is because he is linking that to the book of Zechariah. So there's this whole separate book in the Bible called Zechariah. Now, Zechariah certainly was a real person, but he lived 200 years later, approximately. All this stuff is happening around 700 BC. Okay? The Assyrian attack on Judah is happening around 700 BC or 721 BC, I think, is when Israel fell. And then Zechariah was involved with the restoration after the Babylonian captivity, and that's way in the future. Now, the reason he wants to use Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, from the book of Zechariah is because Zechariah has the vision of the candlesticks, which is about, you know, the truth. According to standard Branch Davidian interpretation, he would be a witness to that, because of what he says here. See, right? Two stories of truth, right? Uriah's story and Zechariah's story. Two different meanings, right? One thing witnessed, two different forms of light. One light is darkness, which is kind of an oxymoron, right? You know what he's saying. One light is light. In other words, so he's applying this to the people that have left the group. So what happened was he has sexual intercourse with Lois Roden. And then he says, well, Uriah the priest is the bad guy. Uriah the priest very quickly was told by his king to make a copy of a pagan altar. He obeyed, built a copy of the pagan altar, and put it in the temple of God. The story is related in Kings. So that makes him sure he's witnessing this event, but he doesn't know the truth. That's David Koresh's interpretation. But Zechariah, the son of, and again, from David Koresh's point of view, the Jeb Berechiah and Berechiah are the same. He said one time that the J-E prefix was just like in Hosea, where it says Lo Ruhamah and Lo Ami, where Lo is no, I think, in Hebrew. Anyway, of course, Lo and Lo and J-E are not the same, right? So, yeah. So this is a coping mechanism, in my opinion. This is a very elaborate interpretation of this particular text to then turn around, because look, if he's super embarrassed about what he did with Lois Roden, he has to come up with a defense mechanism to turn it around. He's not going to stop, right? A different kind of person might have ran out the door and we never saw him again. As soon as Lois Roden said, hey, we had sex, and because you're not supposed to have sex outside of marriage anyway, they never got married. So the whole thing is a joke. It's a violation of the law. So a different kind of person might have said, jigs up, runs out the door, runs off of Mount Carmel, we never see him again. But that's not what Vernon did. He stuck around. He kept talking. He keeps pushing forward and coming up with new narratives and new talking points to counteract, you know, these kinds of issues. And this is one of them. His interpretation of this particular text is a defense mechanism. So now he's using it all these years later. Okay, this is 5 years later, 6 years later. He's using his interpretation of this text to condemn Mark and others for, you know, we're the ones that see the things that he's doing, but we see it as darkness because we don't have the light, right? You know, me, for example, yeah. So it's not a compliment, obviously. It's a bad thing. So let's continue.
Two stories of truth. Two different meanings. One thing witnessed, two different forms of light. One light is darkness, one light is light. That's what I'm talking about. Who will stand in the great judgment?
And my final comment is, you can come up with elaborate interpretations of Isaiah 8 and spin it all around. One thing I'll say, also I want to say is, I forgot about this. Lois Roden was supposed to have a baby. I mean, that's what it says, right? If you're going to fulfill Isaiah 8:3, what does it say? And I, Vernon Howell, went unto the prophetess Lois Roden, and she conceived and bare a son. Does that look conditional to you? Is that a conditional prophecy? Obviously, Lois Roden never had a baby, because that would have been a miracle, because she was like 67? Yeah, 67 years old. So that would have, I mean, because if you were going to do this, and there were no witnesses, he didn't do any of this. You know, he would have called Perry Jones in and maybe George Roden. Hey, and him and his wife, Lois, would have got, hey, we're going to do this thing. She's going to get pregnant. Write it down. Record it. We're going to call the baby Mareshal Hashbaz, and then something's going to happen. I don't know what he would have said about Damascus, because obviously these are literal nations at war. I don't know what he would have said about that. But anyway, he never did any of that. Instead, he went into Lois Roden one night in the dark, in secret. Nobody knew. And he did the deed. As to personal motivations, I'm not going to comment on that. Okay? Why a 24-year-old would want to have sexual intercourse with a 67-year-old woman, I don't know. I really don't care. I know that they did it. He had motivations at the time, but it was all secret. And then, and she was supposed to have a baby. That's what the text says. So if you're going to fulfill Isaiah 8, then you need to fulfill it. But what he said later is, well, she disobeyed, and so the baby wasn't born, and she even claimed to be pregnant at one point. I've told that story. Anyway, I'm sorry, this really gets on my nerves, because this is stuff that I was there to see. I know what he's talking about. I know he's spinning. He's spinning things to his advantage, and I don't like that. Okay, that's one of the things I don't like, is someone who is taking up this position of righteous indignation. But I know stuff that he's not talking about. I know history. Like, so, yeah. And we've known people like that in your personal life. That's just the way it goes, right? There are people like that. Sorry to repeat a lot here, but I found a note I made, and I want to read it so as to be very clear about this whole thing. What he is referencing here is an elaborate and highly questionable teaching that he came up with to obfuscate the simple fact that he committed fornication, the thing witnessed, and I was there when Lois Roden herself confessed this sin to the congregation, with Lois Roden in 1983. He told her she would have a baby, which did not come true, obviously. Actually, if I remember correctly, Vernon said the baby ended up being George Roden. But that was a retroactive reinterpretation of what he said. He told Lois she would get pregnant. Years later, he is telling a highly twisted form of this story to someone. It is recorded where he claims he was accused of getting a 67-year-old woman pregnant, emphasizing how hilarious it is that if he actually did do such a thing, it would be a miracle and hardly anything to get upset about. In actuality, there is not a shred of evidence that Lois Roden was ever pregnant. The two forms of light are the dark form, which would be people living in reality and seeing it for what it really was, which is what he did not want you to do. And the light or true form, which he liked, and spiritualized the whole thing so he could then interpret it positively and escape the negative consequences of the whole affair. Here, he has deeply internalized the whole story so that he has fooled even himself. And remember, the easiest person to fool is yourself.
Will it be red, yellow, black, or white? No. No flesh may be saved. Only those who've been made partakers of the Word, the Spirit. Right, Henry? The Word, the Spirit of truth. Spirit tells John to come where? Not on the earth. The earth will pass away, and they that dwell therein shall die in like manner.
Okay, so we're shifting over to another super important concept here. Come up hither. Now, I will say here that, again, this is where I was talking about when I first started, right? So this concept of come up hither, it's not necessarily bad. It's actually pretty insightful. And then the sea of glass, which he talks about, he'll get into that. I don't necessarily disagree with everything here. It's one of his insights. It's actually, I'll grant he has something insightful here, right? But on the other hand, I don't think that God necessarily infused it into his brain. I think that he's just seeing it himself and understanding the text on a very deep level. If you read it over and over and over and over again, you think about it a lot, you might see things that are useful. So, So this come up hither thing is really super important. And he's going to go into it now.
Man of the earth is earthy and is of the world and cannot receive the things of God. Man of heaven is spiritual. And no man has gone to heaven except he which came from heaven. Those are the ones who realize that the Word created all things. They are the offspring of light. They are the sons of the Most High. And they have learned to be so. They have followed the light wheresoever the light went. They did not turn back to the things of the world. They are those who are lightened, and that they are every man that comes into the world that's born of God. This is the true light, which shines in darkness.
So as you can see, heavily drawing on John 1 here, in the beginning was the Word, the Word was with God, which, I mean, the things that he's saying here are certainly valid biblical concepts, but then again, I disagree with the application, that this is him, that he is an offspring of light. No. So, yeah, sure, I agree in principle, but application, no. Here we go.
And the first voice, which I heard as it were of a trumpet, talked with me, which said, come up hither. The Spirit tells John, the prisoner of on the Isle of Patmos, come up to heavenly places. Immediately he was in the mind. He was in the Word. He was in the Spirit. His attentions were being taken from his imprisonment upon earth to the beautiful freedom and glory of heaven. As a man thinketh, so is he. John in the Spirit was a free man. Free man. The world cannot comprehend such life. And in heavenly places, John beheld one on a throne, the highest judicial system in the universe, a rock.
Okay, so all of this I agree with, but then he says, so yeah, all this other stuff, right? This is perfectly fine. John's free. There's one on the throne. All great. This is fine. But then he He says a rock. Well, let's go to Revelation 4. And again, this is maybe a minor point, but it's so he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and sardine stone. Okay, well, I'm pretty sure he's getting rock from stone, but, well, come on. It's a jasper and sardine stone. When we say stone and we're talking about gems, right? We're not talking about rocks. Right? Jasper and sardine stones are gems. The idea is it's a gem. So I disagree. You can see here, of course, artwork of the scene that John's talking about. So I disagree that you just say that it's a rock, a stone is a rock, and you're done. Okay, rock imagery is a different kind of imagery, right? Like the Rock of Gibraltar. And I'm not saying you can't see God as a rock. Sure, you can, but he's saying that specifically that this verse is referring to the rock. What is that? I can't remember the term when you compare one thing to another. It's a comparison, right? My brain is going. Anyway, yeah. Again, it's a minor quibble, but the emphasis is that he's like a jasper and sardine stone. And there's a rainbow and it's like an emerald, right? Like there's no rock here. There's pretty gems and rainbows. So, yeah. So, anyway, let's continue. Because, boy, he makes a big deal about this rock thing. Like, man, he'll just go on and on about it.
And uniquely enough, this rock was identified. Because beside the throne, around about the throne, was a rainbow. A beautiful, glorious rainbow. There you see it, the light. The light of God's Word. The light placed in a prism to where men can see that the Word of God is light. Just as distinct and separable as life itself is. The rainbow is the interpretation of the reflection of the prism of God. God's Word is a prison house. We are trapped within it. We do not know it, yet it still exists. The children of prophecy are the children that shall be, and they do not know that they are.
I find this, we're starting to get into some word salad here. I don't know why he goes from prism to prison house. If anybody has ideas, go ahead and put them in the comments. He uses the word reflection against minor point. We're talking about refraction, not reflection, but, you know, whatever. Okay, so the children of prophecy are children that shall be. I would assume he's talking about what he's mentioned earlier, that if you are in prophecy, then that means you're hid in the mind of God and that you'll be saved, right? I think that's what he's talking about. Oh, wait a minute. He's talking about
In the world. In the spirit. They're the children of darkness who never come to the light, although they are that light. They never come to the knowledge of the truth. As an untimely birth, they will never see the sun, the psalmist says. than there are the children of light, who by the reflection of God's own imagery.
The psalmist says, that's Psalm 58:8, as a snail which melteth, let every one of them pass away like the untimely birth of a woman, that they may not see the sun. So he's talking about the bad people here. I apologize. I got that wrong, I guess. Yeah, I'll fully admit, I don't completely understand everything he's talking about. Hey, maybe that means I'm one of the children of darkness, right? I don't think so, but, you know, whatever.
He turns light into darkness and makes darkness light. They see the clouds, they see the rain, they see the revealed will of the Spirit, God's word in creation. As it is now raining, they see that in the rain, there is a new truth revealed. As the light shines through, they see the rainbow, a memorial that the light of God is to be seen, the light that shines in darkness. How can light shine in light? How can light not manifest the world? Well, don't you see the rainbow? Can you touch the rainbow? Can you feel the rainbow? What do they say about the rainbow? At the end of the rainbow, there is a pot of gold. Oh, that must be a counterfeit of the true pot of gold.
So, I guess his ultimate point is the rainbow represents the word of God. Okay, won't argue with that.
Huh. Well, it's simple. Did not the Holy Ghost tell the Church of Laodicea that they were in a condition that they couldn't see? Like, don't they see it? Don't they see it?
I can only assume he's saying that they see it, but it's like the Uriah and Jeberechiah. It's like the Uriah priest Jeberechiah thing, where you see it, but then for you it's darkness, and then the other true children of light see it, and it's, yeah, something like that.
The Spirit said, let there be light in the day of creation. And then the Bible records the sun, moon, and stars were made on the fourth day. Well, there is the light of this world, sun, moon, and stars. But then there is the light of the world beyond, God's world. God's light. Do you understand that, class? Do you understand you're not going to go anywhere unless you learn how to fall on the rock of God's word?
This is a very common phrase in the group, fall on the rock. You know how, we have phrases we use in pop culture. This was a phrase used in the group, fall on the rock. Excuse the crudeness, but sometimes it could be like if you're frustrated with somebody and you just tell them to F off, you know, like in the group, if you were frustrated with somebody, just fall on the rock, right? In other words, just get your shit together, right? Like, yeah. My comment on that would be, sure, right? Because again, the rock is the thing that doesn't move, right? Right. The idea is, here's you, and with all your feelings, and here's the rock, and you just, you know, you can't move the rock. I'm sure you all get it. Your flesh and blood and very, you know, you're fragile as hell, right? But the rock is like freaking super strong, and so you conform to the word of God, right? So this is true as far as it goes, but is he really doing it? Right? I think not. Are those people doing it there? They're trying to. They think they are, but I don't think they really are. I think that their rock is an illusion. Okay, because again, they're abandoning fundamental basic biblical principles and essentially adding to the word of God. Now remember, when I express these things, that's my opinion based on my own experience and what I've been through. So it's like I said at the beginning, he's relating truths that are generally true from a spiritual point of view, which means it shows that he has a conception of these things, but then he actually turns around and lives in darkness, in my opinion, by violating the word of God and creating justifications for it.
We don't walk by sight in this message. For 5 years I have suffered in the flesh.
6 years. This is 89. He started in 83. 89 minus 83 is 6. I don't know why he keeps saying 5 years.
My guts have rotted out because I have walked in the light of God's word.
This is an exaggeration. This is hyperbole. Okay, his guts didn't rot out. He had stomach problems, which sometimes I think were exaggerated. In fact, I know they were exaggerated because my wife saw him exaggerating one time. I don't think we told that story, but yeah, saw it with her own eyes. I'm not going to tell that story now. It's complicated, but yeah. He's, you know, this is, you know how people are. Oh man, I've suffered. Ugh. I've suffered so much. Mm-hmm. Right. A lot of his problems were of his own making.
Word that you could not see. My body and my flesh have decayed within my guts because of the anxiety and turmoil of my mind. I have won the crown.
I mean, to me, my response is, oh, poor baby. You know, sorry, not buying it.
I have endured the race. I have seen the vision.
Mm.
I have exalted that testimony.
This is all bullshit. This is self-promotion. Okay? He hasn't endured shit. He has, at this point, when he's talking here, he has utterly failed morally. Okay? He has done horrible, immoral things to children and destroyed marriages in the name of God. This is what makes me angry, this kind of ridiculous nonsense.
Because you were in need of it. You people, you were the ones who gathered around and shook your head yes.
What did I say? I have some notes here I should have been reading, I guess. Okay. You were the ones who gathered around and shook your head yes. This reminds me of an image of a man who wants to be agreed with, so he fills an auditorium full of bobbleheads and sets them all in motion to bobbing them, then as he speaks to them, is amazed that they all agreeing to everything he says as they shake their heads yes. As someone who shook his head no once, I can tell you it did not go well. From my experience, everything he says about this topic is bullshit. Yeah. You couldn't shake your head no. So this is a self-fulfilling prophecy from my own experience. Okay? So really, ultimately, he is a liar. We didn't all shake our heads yes. I shook my head no, but I don't count, right? Because I'm, again, everything is set up in his mind with the narratives and all of the constructs that I, look, when I talked about the Uriah the priest thing and the Zechariah son of Jeberechiah thing, all of that is set up to get a predetermined outcome. Okay? So this thing, you people shook your head yes, like that doesn't mean anything to me. I shook my head no. Mark shook his head no. We all, a lot of us, shook our head no when he went into the pit of hell and destroyed marriages and took men's wives away from them. I shook my head no, vigorously. He didn't want to hear about it. He didn't care. And he turns around and says, oh, well, you're just a child of darkness. Right? So if you have a filter, right, where you just filter out everybody you don't agree with, and then you leave the people behind that do agree with you, and they all shake your head yes, Why is that impressive? I'm not impressed with it.
You are the ones who accumulated. You are the ones who contended with the Spirit of the living God. I never believed the message. I believed you. You were in need. You were the little sheep in need of a shepherd. You were the ones who, with your mind, I knowing in my flesh, you being far more smarter than I, you were the ones who shook your head yes.
He doesn't really believe that. You being far smarter than I. He's so this here, he's schmoozing the audience, right? Hey, you guys are great. You agreed with me. You shook your head yes. Oh, you guys are so smart because you all followed me. I'm just an idiot. God inspires me, and then, you know, whatever. Yeah, sure.
And I went on, and I kept following the Spirit. I kept following the truth, and I kept hearing the words and seeing the visions, and I kept showing you from the Word of God where it was at. But not once did I ever cease to think in my body that I was being led of the devil.
I don't believe him. That's a lie. I don't believe that that's what he really thought. Sorry. Again, remember, I was there, and I observed behavior over periods of time. Now, there are others who may have been there and known him and may disagree with me. Okay. We disagree. Ultimately, I would say at this point in time, right, here we are in the year 2024. Quite frankly, according to all this stuff going on here, we're not even supposed to be here. There's no framework in Koresh's prophetic box. There's no possibility of a year 2024 that exists the way we are here today. He would have laughed at me. If I told him, if I had had some kind of prophetic vision, okay, and I had told him back in 1989, well, in 2024, I'm going to be 58 years old, I'll be making YouTube videos complaining about you, and you're going to be gone. Some people maybe don't believe he's actually dead, but he's in heaven or something, I'm not sure, but he's gone. He's right, he's not here. He's gone, he's departed this earth and passed off the scene of history. And I'm left behind as well as other survivors, right? And some people went through enormous tragedy and lost family members and lost their lives and children were killed and the government were a bunch of idiots and handled the whole situation like a bunch of bozos, and all this destruction and chaos and loss of life resulted, even to some other frickin' maniac in 95 bombing Oklahoma City because he thought he was doing something good, right? Another complete maniac, obviously 10 times more evil than Koresh ever was. Actually killing people, you know, like he's, I'm sorry, that's another guy that really gets on my nerves, you know, upset, oh my God, a bunch of people were killed. I know, I'll kill more people. So here I am, right, all the way in the future. And, okay, so, and I apologize if people think, you know, this is personal for me. Right? This is personal. Again, if you've seen my one, how David Koresh tried to destroy my marriage. Okay? This guy sometimes really gets me going with his bullshit. So, yeah, here we are now. 2024. I'm doing a history channel to get things in perspective. I'm expressing my opinions. Try and explain what he's talking about here. And one of the things is to try to tell you that when he says something like this, right, but not once did I ever cease to think in my body that I was being led of the devil. Now, he may have had a thought like that on occasion, but he says, but not once did I ever cease to think that? No, come on. This is hyperbole, obviously. This is hyperbole, not actually true, right? And I said that about the fishing pole, which is coming up.
I never not once ceased to think that I would be the one who would eventually be lost. And every one of you would eventually be saved because I knew you were sincere. I knew you wanted the truth. But I of myself, I knew my heart. I hated the message. I hated the truth. I even hated you. I felt in my body every pain of anxiety of a one that stands before God a hypocrite. Even the truth that came out of my mouth was a lie to me. In my feelings, I would point out the points of doctrine, and I would see the points to be so. But that did not mean that my body felt that I wanted it.
You know, because when I would point out to him where he was wrong, the defense mechanisms would come up. He would snap into this mode and just do everything he could to avoid the truth. Okay? In my opinion. My personal experience with the man. This is all... let's just say that this whole thing here that he's talking about is his point of view. Right? It's his point of view... from a certain position that is an ideal construct position, if you know what I'm talking about. I'm going to look more at the camera here. So it's historically useful if you want to know this section here, right? It's really important if you want to understand how he perceived himself. Ideally, right? Ideally, this is the perfect ideal of how he perceives himself. This is what he wants you to think about him. Okay? He wants you to believe it. Okay? So there you go. He's self-promotion. He's promoting himself. This is his truth.
I want simple things. I want a fishing pole and a rod. That's all I want. I want to go fishing. That's all I care about in life.
Again, what I just said. That's what he wants you to believe.
I'm one of those fools, you see. But you were in need. You were the one that agreed to the doctrine. And I persevered. And now I see the truth. And
For example, when he got Nicole Gent in 89 or 90... I don't know how I know this. It came down through the grapevine, and I'm sure he confessed it himself. That's what I'm saying. He wasn't consistent in his own personal story. He said, well, he wanted to run away with Nicole and just start a new life with her. Well, how does that mesh with he just wants a fishing pole and a rod and reel? Like maybe he wanted to go fishing with her, I guess. In other words, he would want different things at different times. But then to say that he didn't want to, like Aisha, for example, and the Aisha story we haven't told, and Mark Bro is involved with the Aisha story. Ugh. Yeah. I mean, if you tell that story and know the facts, what he said right here. Yeah, right, dude. Please give me a break.
Now I will be exalted. Now I will give you the test. I will put the baton in your hand. Let's see if you can't walk through the paths of darkness where the greatest enemy of all is yourself, where your body will scream, damn, and cuss within, and your guts will fall out, and your bowels will become hardened, and you'll end up digging the crap out of your bowels because fear and anxiety, self will stare you in the face every day and hack your head every day showing you you don't care about the Word of God.
This story here is legendary. I have a note. He had to do this because his diet at times is horrible. I talked to his ex-girlfriend, Sandy. We talked about this. He used to tell her about this stuff. A little bit of TMI, really. Yeah. Again, what I will say, and I think it's obvious to you guys, going through very difficult personal experiences in combination with maybe something spiritual is an experience that a lot of people have. And they are deeply subjective. Okay? That's what I'll say.
The Word of God is true, and men are liars. The Word of God is truth. It is light. And men are shadows of darkness. That's what I've learned. But now in a time when man is revealed to me, I will declare the light. I will show you he of whom I have hoped in. My God is a hard, cold, feelingless, true one of a rock. Jacob laid his head upon him. Jacob suffered fear and anxiety for years. Jacob knew heartache, terror.
I will say that he has a valid point in the sense that people who want to go through life and they think that because they believe in God and they know the truth, that everything will always be rosy, sunshiny. Well, that's not really true, right? Because, yeah, he's right. If you read the Bible, there's adversity, there's pain, there's sorrow. Sure. The thing with Jacob, and then Jacob wrestled with God, right? Because he wouldn't give up. So, yeah, like I said, he's not wrong about everything. It's mixed.
I want to show you about a God that you haven't yet known. You've all been spoon-fed. You've all been diaper-padded.
This is 1989. For him to say that in 1989, based on what we've already been through, like, look, man, he would turn on us at the drop of a hat. Let me explain. There was a guy who came to the group in 88, 89. This guy drove a truck. He was a mechanic. So this was a man of the world. From what I could tell about the guy, he wasn't a bad guy. He's just kind of this average guy, drove a truck. He was a mechanic, had a beard. He probably, you know, just an average guy, not super highly sophisticated, intelligent guy, just your average dude. But he came into the group and David Koresh really wanted to recruit him. Now this guy ended up being the type of person that had no time for sitting and listening to Koresh run his mouth. And the reason why I know that is because I heard him say it. Because he lived next door to me and my wife, and I overheard him comment, because I think somebody told him it's time to go to the meeting. And he said, oh, you know, I got better things to do than listen to Koresh run his mouth all day, which for at the time was a very unique perspective, let me tell you, because that's supposed to be the greatest thing in the world, to sit there and listen to Koresh give his message. But this guy was also jaded and cynical about us, because Koresh, in talking to him and trying to recruit him, he said he would look around and say, look at these people. You know, they don't really believe. He would just started running us down. Because, you know, he's not buying the story, right? Which, I mean, he might have had a point. But the thing is, he didn't really know for sure. Like, he'd only been around for a week or two. Actually, being in the group was a real pain in the ass. You had to give up so much. I know. Especially with those last 10 months I lived there. It was really, really hard to live in this place. I'm telling you. It was a nightmare. And Vernon turns around and agrees with the guy. And even told the story. Yeah, he's right. You guys don't know crap. You know, you guys are horrible. You guys don't believe the message. So it's the opposite of what he just said earlier. Remember when he said, yeah, it's the opposite of what he just said. So then he says this. Sure, man. Whatever.
And now it's time for this cloak to be thrown off, and you're going to go through the fire. You're going to see whether you believe this mess.
Ooh. I never noticed that before. Yeah, that's sad. You're going to go through the fires.
I'm ready to be delivered. I'm ready to go to the portals of darkness and death. And you're not. Let's see if you believe the message after so many years. The rock sits upon a throne. The amen. The final word. And next to him stands a rainbow a memorial of his word, his light. And those who go contrary to this word, to this light, are Babylonians.
So that's another super important concept, Babylonians. So I would have, he would have considered me a Babylonian. The day we got kicked out of the group, which was May 4th, 1989, we had acquired some kittens. And they were in our room with us. We were getting kicked out. The cats came up, I guess, the subject of who was going to get them or who was going to take care of them, because we couldn't take them with us. And he called them Babylonian cats. I swear to God, and then I'll just leave it at that.
They are children of darkness. Their horns can only reproduce, Babylonians.
For Koresh, horn means penis. Full stop. Okay. I can prove that that's not true. If you want to look it up yourself, read the story of, I think, Hannah. What is it? 1 Samuel? Yeah, let's look it up. So Hannah was the one who wanted to have a baby. She was barren. And so Hannah was a woman. Okay. Hannah prayed and said, "My heart rejoices in the Lord. Mine horn is exalted." So Hannah's a woman. Her horn is exalted. She doesn't have a penis. So horn doesn't always mean penis. Okay. There's the end of that Bible study. Destroyed. I just destroyed that doctrine in 1 minute. Okay. What I'm saying is, to him, there was no exception. I might grant, okay, in certain contexts, you'd have to look at the text carefully and check it, right? No. Just means penis, done.
Because they are a seed of falsehood, children of the adulterer and of the whore. Their mouths are open to contradict the clearest statement of the testimony of this God.
You mean what you did? You frickin' bozo. I mean, for those of you who are familiar with the Bible and understand marriage, right? Like, this is a guy who said, who took men's wives and said that they weren't married. Literally looked Steve Schneider in the eye and told him that he wasn't really married to Judy. Right? Like, when they first met each other and were started falling in love, he was like a little snot-nosed brat who didn't know shit about anything and had this love they'd built over years. And then this idiot who comes along and can't control himself. "Oh, you're not really married, Steve. I get her." And then he says something like this. "Contradict the clearest statement of the testimony of God. You mean where it says thou shalt not commit adultery? Do you mean where it says thou shalt not covet a man's wife? Do you mean where it says let what God has joined together, let no man put asunder? You mean that testimony? This is why I get so angry. And again, I'm evil, right? I'm a Babylonian." Ugh, this guy.
The final say, the amen. John witnesses to God and sees a jury of 24 elders. They are kings. They have been crowned as so. And they are amazed at the wonderment of this rock. There are four creatures, living creatures. Nebuchadnezzar, we know, represented these creatures. Men who think they are rich and increased with goods, learning shortly after 7 years of eating grass, that as an ox is happy eating grass, so can men be made the same. We can be made happy to eat shit. God wanted us to. We could be a bug. There are bugs who love shit. There are bugs who, when shit lands on the ground, they grow in it. They live in it. They love it. Isn't God's foolishness wise? How would you like to be a fly and be raised in shit? If you were made a fly by God's wisdom, you would enjoy it, wouldn't you?
Self-evident, this stuff, sure.
We have been made men, and now it's time to be made gods. It's time to think like God. It's time to act like God. It's time to talk like God.
Yeah, too bad you didn't follow your own advice.
God does not change. He is a rock. That's my foundation. The jury is better than any of you. They have crowns of gold. They're honored of this rock. The living creatures, they somehow or the other, they feel that God is holy, 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 and they cease not day and night referring to this rock. In the right hand of this rock, there is a book. Only those who are in heavenly places can comprehend that there is a book.
Okay, so we're getting into super core stuff here now, having to do with the book. The book, I guess I better go to Revelation 5. I think it's Revelation 5. Yeah. It's a book. I saw in the right hand of him that sits on the throne a book written within it on the backside, sealed with seven seals. So we are going to stop here because I've already gone on quite a bit, and we're transitioning into Revelation 5 now. And I've... Let me just close with this. You know, I have a varied audience. Okay? Some of you are more with me on Koresh. Other of my viewers think Koresh had more in the truth direction. And like I said earlier, I'm tired. It's been so long. So much time has gone by. I'm not trying to convert anybody here. I'm expressing my opinions. I'm coming from my experience and kind of expressing my truth. I get, I don't really believe that truth is subjective. I believe that people can be subjective, but I do believe in an overall objective ultimate truth. But, you know, I'm just this frail old person now who's been through this, and I have a good life now. You know, I'm doing okay. It's not perfect. I don't have everything I want, but it's come out okay. And I'm like a lot of you. We're just living our lives every day and just trying to make it, you know? And so I'm just trying to explain what he's talking about and then also explain what I feel about it. And we're getting into some heavy-duty stuff here. It even gets worse after this. It's kind of hard for me sometimes because it brings back a lot of feelings. It brings back his... Anyway, if you want to know, if you're a new viewer and you want to know what I went through with this guy, you could watch my video, David Koresh Tried to Destroy My Marriage, okay? And what my wife went through. So, yeah. Anyway, we'll stop here. We're getting into the book. Yeah. We're going to get some heavy-duty stuff next time. So until then, take care. I hope you enjoyed part 3 of this. I apologize if I ramble too much. I'll try to do better in the future. Take care.